Scooby-Doo, so
yeah.
Hey, everybody, welcome back. I'm Emily Moyer. Danny Katz is here with me. 30 minutes ago, I was like, oh my God, am I going to be able to do this? But lights, camera, action. Here I am. This is Words episode number 60. Danny Katz, Thursday afternoon. I didn't even know what day it was.
I did that in the grocery store today because I was going to pay for my little caffeinated beverage and I had Cash Fridays in my mind. And I went to pull out cash and I'm like, wait a minute, is it Thursday or Friday? And he's like, I think it's Thursday. And I'm like, okay, we can use the card today.
What I have.
What, are you so happy to just be immersed in all that high vibe yumminess?
Well, so, okay. I mean, so.
And what's in the cup?
This is a buttery matcha latte. Okay.
Does it have like collagen and MCT and rose MCT. Powder?
It has MCT, matcha, ghee, grass-fed ghee. I don't do all the extra stuff that you do. Like my body doesn't deal well with that stuff.
Okay.
Like I get all of my good vibes from animal stuff at this point, right? So I'm not quite at plants or poison, but I'm almost at plants or poison, right? Well, I think they are... So I think we're using them wrong. I don't think they're literally poison, though they would like us to think that. Like, I don't think we're supposed to digest them. I think we're supposed to use them in tonics and elixirs and whatnot for the most part, right? There's a few exceptions. Like, it's kind of like eat the ones that are the least toxic to you, that cause you the least amount of problems, right? Mm-hmm. And if there's some nutrient that you need from others that you can't eat, then you can get them in like a homeopathic sort of dosage to get the little, like, you know, like the healing properties of it or the necessary properties without trying to digest the whole thing.
See, that's how I feel about meat. Having been vegan for such a long time is like, now I'll do game meat in homeopathic doses just to get the life force and the healing that they give me. But I'm like super intentional about it and it's tiny amounts.
Yeah. So I think it's a different answer for everybody, I do think that there's like this idea that we all must eat a wide variety of foods. That's a mind control program. Like, cause no, most people, like I am pretty strong on like this ancestral thing that like the foods that are going to be the best for you is like within the local area of your origination point in general. Right. Like, cause you know what I'm talking about?
Like where you're born?
Yeah. So like, I think there's a couple ways you can look at it. Like for, in some cases it could be like literally where your family, your ancestors are from. Like that's right. The way what some people do, and others just where you grew up because you're more accustomed to those pollens, those, you know, all that kind of stuff. Right. And that you really shouldn't eat things from, some people say 50 miles, some say 500 miles, things that don't grow in that zone. Right. So like this idea that like, oh, now that we can eat all these foods from all over the world that we should, like, I'm not sure that's a good idea, even though I like all those foods, right? Like, I don't know that our body, like, I think that there was like most back before we had all this shit, people ate what was in their local environment, which was usually like the five same foods most of the time. And during certain seasons, there'd be a few extras and those were treats and they had a little bit of them. And that was kind of it, right? And now it's like, you know, we've been through all these new, like, just like there's been like weight loss or diet fads with low fat or low this or whatever. There's also been this like other thing that isn't so much about weight loss, but is about health, or supposedly about health. That is like, you want to have a wide variety, a vast, you know, amount of different things that you eat. And I don't know that was right. Right. I think like your body likes, it does well with certain things. And I think that evolves over time as well. Right. So you should have a rotating sort of set of things that, like, you know, like I have five or six staple foods that work well for me all the time. And then there's a few other foods that are great as long as I just do them occasionally. And then these other ones, they're kind of harder for me, but I like them. So just a treat or whatever. Right. So I think there's a balance that's slightly different for each person, and what the makeup of those things are would be different for each person. But this idea that we should just have like 500 different foods in our pantry or refrigerator at all time, and we should be eating from all of them, I think that has led a lot of us astray.
Interesting. I mean, I went through a few years of being a creature of habit and eating, you know, just a very small array of the same things all the time. And now I actually just thought of it because I bought zucchini, which is not something that I normally eat, and realizing that my body is doing better with the variety. It's learning how to process and assimilate different foods in different ways. So mm-hmm. I feel like because I was a creature of habit for such a long time, but I think it's very unique to the individual. And I also think it's important to not get stuck in any one way and to be willing to switch it up throughout the course of a lifetime.
Correct. It should be. So what you said, like you had gotten down to this very small amount of foods. And if you stepped it all outside of it, then it was not good. Right.
Right.
So I think that like, and I've been there too. I've been at the vast array. I've been at the eating the same two things. And I think there's like, you know, a point on the scale for each person. And I think that it's like, you know, it's important to test yourself. Just like one needs to have like metabolic flexibility. You need to have like digestive flexibility and assimilation flexibility. And like, you know, while you're trying to sort out what that is for you, you have your core foods that you know are good for you. Then you test a new food, wait a few days, you test another food, you test another. And then when you have like a little bit bigger, that can become your core. You can have 10 then instead of five, right? But it's not like just more variety is better necessarily. It's like the right variety. It's kind of like going to a party. It's like parties that have too many people aren't fun and parties that don't have enough people, but you want like just the right combination or variety and the party can be amazing.
Yeah. Right?
So that, and yeah. And I think also there's like a reason and a season for all of that. And I think like sometimes it's good to come back down to just a couple things and other times it's good to expand for a while. And then I think it's also important that we have times where we're like not actually worrying about it. It's like, I'm just like, I'm traveling and I'm eating what's good or what's available or what's offered to me, or I'm tired of thinking about this all the time. I'm just taking a break for a while. I think all of those things are part of challenging your body for something new all the time. And then there's a few things where just like, it just never works, right? There's like a few foods that like, no matter how much you might want them to work, it's just like, there's no way around that this one doesn't work. Right.
Yeah. That's me and cow.
Yeah. Right. Like, so like, and sometimes it's unfortunate because it's something you really like, right? Like when you have the moment of recognizing that, oh my God, like half of the foods I like have something tomato in them and tomato is the cause of most of my problems. And like, keep trying to figure out a way that it isn't really, if I take the skin off, if I take the seeds out, if I only eat it cooked, if I only eat it cold, if I da 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 da. And it's just like, nah, man, like it gives me terrible gas and I feel awful after I eat it. Right. Like, there's no way around it.
But I think there's something to like a certain type of self-mastery that comes when we relinquish things that don't work for us and we're not like dopamine fixing ourselves. Like I just had it. I go back. And also sometimes some things don't work for me. I hit the wall. And then a couple of years later, I can bring them back a little, you know, like I'm able to bring mate back now, which I wasn't able to have for a long time.
I think some of that is, so two things. I totally agree with you. Like I finally got to the point where I realized that meth didn't work for me. Right. Took a long time, but I finally relinquished it. And like for many years, it was like, okay, that was not good for me. And I stopped doing it. And it's, but now I'm like, you know what? There was a lot of really interesting experiences and I don't think all of them were bad. And I also know that like, I don't need to go there again. Right. So I relinquished it. And then I'm in this sort of reflective phase where I'm really starting to get a better grasp on the experiences I had when I was on it without having to go back and double check kind of thing.
Right.
And then the introduction stuff, like I have the same thing. Some things that used to work great for me don't work for me now. And some things that used to not work, they seem okay. They don't generally become your best power foods after they haven't worked, but sometimes they become okay. And I think that goes along with like the cycle of cells, like the 7 years kind of cycle of cells. And so like if seven, like, right. Like 7 years ago, your body was actually entirely different. Right. And so that like every few years is a good time to go back and check on a food that either you know has some properties that would be good for you if you could handle it, or that you just really like, you can check. And it's always best to do that checking starting from the place of like, my digestion is really in order. So I'm going to eat this and see what happens. And if there's a problem, I know it's that, not exactly. Trying it when you're all fucked up with a bunch of others. Yeah.
I will say that eggs are something that go in and out of my life and I've had serious allergies to. And in like right now and probably for the past year, they are a power food for me.
I go in and out with eggs too. But I'm also starting to get to the point where it's very, very dependent on the egg, right? So when you say you have, just in case you guys didn't know that Words is now a nutrition show, welcome to post Emily's vacation reality, right?
We had a complete redesign.
We look the same, but you know, our cells have turned over. So when you say you've had allergies to eggs, how does that allergy
Skin stuff.
Like itchy?
Like eczema.
Eczema. Okay. And then right now when you're saying it's a power food, like in what way? What do you think it's
making? It gives me energy. It's a good source of protein. I can have a hard-boiled egg for a whole meal and it'll keep me going. Mm-hmm. It's really easy for me to digest.
Yep. It's one of the most filling foods, a hard-boiled egg, right? Yep. It's also great food to drink on a night out at a bar, great food to drink, great food to eat if you're drinking cocktails, mm-hmm. right? A lot of times when you're out drinking, you get into eating food that is creates a bigger problem and whatever. But I used to live around the corner from Kohl's in downtown Los Angeles, you know, the famous French dip place. And they're also, they have great like classic cocktails, but they had pickled eggs at their bar. And that was my favorite drinking snack. I love that, right? Because it's just some protein, a little bit of fat, and you can keep going. And then you're not like, oh my God, I hate myself the next day. Because not only did I have 3,000 million carbs in the drinks, but I also had 3,000 million carbs in the chips and salsa or whatever kind of thing. Yeah, so that's a good one. Okay, so with the eggs, so I get into this a lot of times with clients, right? It's one of the main foods that that I test a lot. And there's a lot of people who like, both things, who are convinced eggs are good for them and turns out really not, and who are convinced eggs are not good for them and it turns out it's okay. Yeah. Right. But I also like, so for me, I don't have things with the skin based on eggs. The thing that happens for me is sometimes like my body feels just off, like a little toxic, like in the joint pain kind of thing.
Yeah.
Or I have trouble keeping them down, right? Mm-hmm. When I say that, I don't mean throwing up. I mean more like spitting up like a baby, right? I don't feel sick. It doesn't hurt my stomach. It doesn't have heartburn. Just my body's like literally not accepting it. Like almost as if, you know, when you put something in your mouth, it just tastes terrible and you feel like you have to spit it out.
That's how I'm with anything sugary, like dates or figs or like my body's just like, we don't want this.
Yeah. So this is like the same thing, but just from the stomach instead of the mouth, right? Yeah. But what I have found is the darker the yolk of the egg, the less likely I am to have any of the not happy responses from the body.
So how do you discern that when it's not cracked open?
You can't. So the only way to discern it is find a source of eggs where they're dark orange and then go back to that over and over and over.
Yeah.
And then the other thing is sometimes for a lot of people, it's the whites of the egg that is a problem. And the yolk, especially if it's a dark orange yolk, is like a really tremendous source of the best kind of cholesterol that is like excellent for your hormones, excellent for every mood, sex hormones, metabolism, everything. So just eat it raw. Just crack the egg open, separate off the white, eat the dark yolk raw, and they give you a lot of energy and they can be temporarily filling. And it gives you the good part of the egg without the part that I actually think that, like, I'm just getting intuitively in my body, when you do have skin issues for you, it's the white, right? Mm-hmm. Like I feel it because I was thinking about eating the egg white and I started to feel like the dry scaliness of skin on myself, right? Mm-hmm. So
that makes sense.
Anywho, so we found like a source that had like 99.99% of the time the yolks are dark orange. And if they're not the darkest, they're still darker than most of the other ones on the market. So right. Even though they're not cheap, we do those as often as
I splurge on my eggs to keep them, because I don't, if the chicken's eating shit, I don't want that shit coming into my body.
The chicken eat mostly bugs. Like the more bugs the chicken is eating, the darker orange the yolk is going to be.
Yeah. And very free. I want them to be free and happy living on the land.
Living on the land, having a good old time, right?
Yeah.
Anywho, all right.
This concludes our nutrition show.
Back to the Erewhon thing. So I, first of all, it's always great to go to a place where everybody knows your name. So I went to the new Erewhon, which I've been there before, and still people recognize me from there because I used to go to Erewhon every day. So there's
managed. Where's the new one?
On Coldwater Canyon, where at Enterprise Sportsman
Valley?
Yeah.
Oh my God.
And so a couple of people recognized me on my first tour through yesterday. I went back today. Nice to see you again, right? Prices have gone up significantly.
Which is almost impossible to fathom given how high they already were.
Right. And so I don't know, like, so I haven't done enough looking around at things here in Los Angeles yet to figure out if this is a Los Angeles thing or if this is an Erewhon thing. Because prices in Texas, at least the places that I shop, since I've been there for a year, there's been a little bit of inflation, but like nothing significant enough for me to be like, wow, this is an issue, right? It's just been like, you know, okay, whatever. It seems like more like yearly average cost, you know, that kind of stuff, right? So I'm interested to go around looking everywhere else to see if it's standard that everything's gone up about that much or if Erewhon has just gone off to the races.
Some
items that I used to buy that were like in the $3 to $5 range are now in the $6 to $7 range, right? That's a lot for an item that.
So they doubled them.
Almost double. I'd say a third to two thirds price on some stuff. Things got smaller. Like literally I bought some sushi there. Like I love this. This is what you gotta love about Erewhon. The way that they're hiding their inflation is while the piece of fish looks as big, it's thinner, right? So it's
that's kind of clever though. It's a clever way to screw your customer.
Right? It's thinner kind of thing. So there's some of that going on and whatnot. So it's just like, wow, okay. Like it's outrageous. It was already outrageously expensive, but now it's just kind of like, if stuff is this outrageous, money can't be real. This all has to be a game. So does it even matter anyway?
It doesn't matter. I know. Yeah. For me, what I've noticed is all my weird vegan milks, they have all totally skyrocketed.
Yeah, because you're not willing to take the ones that are just full of guar gum and carrageenan, and you actually want the stuff in there.
No, I need the like almonds and salt and water, and that's it.
That's it. Yeah. Have you ever made your own?
Sorry?
Have you ever made your own?
Yeah, I have, but A, it's time consuming and I have so much going on, and B, I never really know what to do with the guts, you know, and then just keeping up with the guts, it's like stressful. I used to donate them to a raw restaurant. And like, I've just come to the point where I realize like, if it's going to be like kitchen stuff or more time to write and read and play with my puppets, like my creativity is always going to trump homemaker shit.
Totally. Yeah. I get you. I hear you. So anyway, it was great to have, it felt nice to be recognized, right? Thank you very much. Felt nice, right? It's just, you know, I also it's become such a swindle, Erewhon, that I don't know how high vibe it really is anymore.
No, it's not.
At this point, I'm just satisfying the stomach of a cancer, right? Like I like the food. I think it's delicious. I don't know that this is that these are my people or anything like that.
No, they're not. And I know we've talked about Erewhon before, but I started going to Erewhon in the 90s when it was like still just like this, the single owner. And, you know,
she was a client of Anne's. Right.
Okay. So her son, Joe, was the checker who would only charge me for like every other thing. But then when they sold out just for the rich people, I went in and it was the same grocery manager on Beverly that had been there forever. And I was looking for like, I think it was raw. It was like raw pecans or raw. And he's like, oh, we don't carry those anymore. And I'm like, but those are a staple. Like you were the only one in town that wouldn't. And he's like, we're not catering to like your people anymore. Like it's just about the money now. And like he said it flat out, you know, and that was like probably like 2017.
Yeah. So,
but I do miss, and I was thinking about this today, the beverage culture of like, there's so many places in LA, and I did this when I was in Sedona as well, because I am kind of a sucker for like, if I can get a matcha with pearl powder and lion's mane and like all those other things. And then I'm kind of spending like $30 or $40 on beverages every day, which is probably a good reason why I'm not living in those cultures. But I miss that kind of like tonic bar elixir culture.
So I always think that like, if I ever, and I've been spending a lot of time thinking about this the last week or two, if I ever do open a bar, right? I've been spending a lot of time thinking about opening a bar, but if I ever opened a bar, that would be part of it too, because not everyone drinks alcohol, but everybody still, like, mixology can be present whether there's liquor or not, right? And I think that like, there's also like an untapped market for people who like, well, I'm not really doing it to be healthy. I'm not doing the liquor to be healthy. Like I want my drink to be interesting and I want it to evoke as many like, you know, like when you go wine tasting or coffee tasting or whiskey tasting, you're going for the notes and seeing like what memory or what emotion or whatever that little scent or that taste evokes and stuff. Mm-hmm. Like I think that people who don't like alcohol or don't drink coffee for health reasons or any other reason still like that experience of like, that is fucking weird. Like why does my coffee taste like a nectarine? Like that is awesome. Fun, right?
So I love the idea of you opening a bar. And for me, I was talking, there's a place here called Remix, and it's like a DJ school cafe. Mm-hmm. And they have dance parties at night, and they have like, you know, turmeric ginger reishi lattes, which is perfect for me. Yeah. And for me, what like it's less about taste and flavor for me. It's more about how can I alter and tinker and alchemize my consciousness. Totally. And especially at night, like I want cordyceps, I want reishi spores, I want things that are gonna keep me up and allow me to dance, but not make me feel shitty the next day. Like I'm not gonna do coffee, you know, late at night. So right. For me, that's the perfect place that like, and I don't mind sharing space with people who are drinking alcohol, but I wanna have like a Jun or a Cava or, you know, like a Kratom beverage or, you know, some sort of adaptogenic something that's gonna actually help me drop into whatever the frequencies are that are being like cultivated and curated in the space.
And it would also be awesome if your drink tasted good too. Like I know, yes. This is not yes. Priority, but I think this is what, like, this is the difference between someone who's able to deliver a service and someone who's an artist or a mixologist is they, I should be able to take all those things you just asked for and make it taste good.
100%.
Right. And make it taste so good that even a person who's normally wanting an alcoholic beverage is like, damn, that tastes good. I'll have that. Can you put a shot of whiskey totally. In that? Or whatever, right?
Totally, like, totally.
So I like that stuff, right? I like all of that. Like the sort of, we went whiskey tasting when Jeff was visiting right before we went out of town, right? And we went to Treaty Oak in, which is about half an hour outside of Austin. Right. And we did this VIP tasting. Right. So we got to taste 5 different single barrel whiskeys and do like all these notes and that kind of stuff. And then we got to have like a wax dip bottle from whichever barrel we wanted to tap. Right. Based on what we tasted. And there was one whiskey that I didn't end up choosing that as the one I wanted a full bottle from because it's not the one that I like liked the best. But it was the one that was the most intriguing to me in terms of as soon as I tasted it, it made me smell red vines. Like when you would remember when you were little and you'd open the package of red vines, that smell?
Every movie.
Right. Okay. So it tasted a little like that and it smelled like that. And I was just fascinated with doing that like over and over and over again, right? Kind of like, I remember like when my cat was a kitten and she learned to jump up on the bed, she spent all day jumping off and jumping on, jumping off and jumping on. Like I wanted to just keep having that experience. And it wasn't one of the notes that they had put listed that they think you'll find there. But like, that to me was what came. And I was telling him about it. And he's like, yeah, I mean, the notes are not about that. Those things are actually, I mean, I know this from years and years of wine tasting and whiskey tasting and coffee tasting. But it's the fun of like, what are you? It's like looking at the clouds when you were little and you would show me, you know, you might show me that you saw a bunny rabbit and I might say, no, it's a mouse. And right. It's like that. Right.
Right.
It's kind of fun, but it's like a way of playing with your own senses. And then like what you said, the memory of going to the movies as a kid or wherever you had after that, like I fucking wanted red vines. Yeah. Right. And so forth. I figured the best I could do, I found Red Vines has an organic version now that at least has real sugar, no food coloring, and no corn syrup. And they happened to have it in the airport on the way to Mexico. So I bought the Red Vines and I ate them, right? But that, like, that is a really cool thing you can do with these types of distilled or extracted beverages and concoctions.
Right.
Person is going to find something else in it that they appreciate or don't, right? So
yeah.
I love it.
Yay.
All right, now we can move on.
Okay,
so let's do this. Let's hear, you want to start zooming in on consilience. So let's do that.
Okay.
And then in the afterwards segment, we're going to respond to, there were lots of comments on both the public and the private hour last time. So thank you. And I just returned from a trip. So while I've browsed some of them, I haven't had a chance to look at them in a way that that is respectful of how much time some of you spent working on your response. So we will get to those, but there was one that didn't really require any research or looking into things or links that I felt was a very, very, it was not a critical comment, but it was a comment that brought up something that I often ask myself every time I'm doing a show, right? And I think it was a fair question and I have multiple answers and I don't think there is one right answer to the question. So I want to talk about that a little bit. And I also want to, there was something I forgot to say when we did our segment on Daniel and David last time, because we went down a different path with it than I expected, but I forgot to make a major point. So those two things will be in the afterwards, but right here in the main segment, let's get to consilience.
Okay. All right. So picking up where we left off, we had SFI leading into Lifeboat. And then my theory is that Daniel Schmachtenberger's Consilience Project is the disinformation / propaganda arm of SFI and Lifeboat combined.
Okay.
And this is the type of thing that, like, once you start to see the pattern, then you can't unsee it. Mm-hmm. And it seems pretty obvious. Mm-hmm. And I love that Jim Rutt was on Dark Horse Podcast this week, because Jim Rutt is the former president of SFI and Brett Weinstein is part of the Consilience Project. And if you look at Jim Rutt's guests, if you look at Rebelwism's guests, which we'll look at, you see that it's all either SFI, Lifeboat, or fellow Consilience folks. All right, so I'm trying to figure out where to start us. So I'm just gonna screen share and just go to my file and we'll kind of take it from there.
Okay.
But I also have some links that I pulled up that I also want us to go through. So,
Jamie Wheel, Navy SEAL. I liked it. It rhymes.
Okay. So let's just go through we've gone through the team a few times,
okay.
But just to be super clear, like, I just kind of want to go through it again. Of course we have Schmachtenberger. We have these people at the bottom. We have Tristan Harris, Jordan Hall. We will come back to Jordan Hall. I have some extra stuff on him.
Okay.
Nora Bateson, Gregory Bateson's daughter, granddaughter, she is part of Lifeboat Foundation as well.
Mm-hmm.
So Jamie Wheel, the reason why I had noted what you just saw, also, why are all these like military folks in it? Like, right. This is the other thing that I want to draw our attention to in all of these is,
is Phoebe Tickle.
So you mentioned her before, and she's, what is it, decentralized? I mean, it got cut off, but some sort of decentralization thing. But just notice all the people who are on this board. We have Medicine Biosciences. So Jamie Wheel, we've talked about, he's got the ethical cults and his whole thing with psychedelics. We have this retired colonel, associate surgeon general. Like, it's just kind of odd considering that they say that they're a media education company, right. And there's no one in this company, look, financial intelligence, machine learning, there's no military intelligence, open societies. Again, we keep seeing that term, from Soros, Bates and Complex Systems, FSI, no one's in media.
Right.
None of these people are in media, given that the whole thing is about media. No diversity, equity, inclusion, strategic intelligence, and national security. Do you know what I'm saying?
No one's in media. And this is the thing. Like, if you're presenting your project as a solution to the things that are going on now, which you're pretending to be critical of.
Right.
Right. Then wouldn't there be someone on your board who questions the ethics of all the things these people do? And wouldn't that person be someone who most of these people like have large opposition to, right? So I'm not saying that this would ever happen, right? But the thing to do, like if you want you and I to buy in and to stop warning our audiences about these people, right?
Like, bring us on.
Bring us on, or James Corbett, or Melissa Melton from Truth Stream Media, or Richard Grove, or there's a handful of people that I think are sort of trusted and respected, even by people within our own communities that disagree with them on one topic or another or whatnot. They've been around for a while, they do good research, and they'll ask some questions, right?
Right.
I understand that, like, you and I may be a little too direct or a little bit too much Meshuggah or whatever for something like that.
But someone who's poised and polished and white and male could do it.
And someone who's going to, or just whatever, and get up there and be able to, you know, say, you know, I'm, you know, and here's the other thing, right? Like, why are people like, where's the person who's like, I don't know if we want to base our company around people who were like dumb enough to fall for the, you know, defend your country, join the military thing per se. Now, you and I both know that there's different roles in the military that are about intelligence, that they don't actually think that they're defending their country when they go into them, right?
Right.
But this is supposedly a piece, like a sort of hippie, anti-war, sort of left-leaning cultural solution. Like when I was a kid, like, I don't know, like, I'm not saying this is the right way to think or feel. I'm not saying I'm right. Right. I didn't have any respect for people in uniform. I'm like, dumb fuck fell for that shit. Right. So right. Like, where's the person on the board to question that?
So yeah, there are none of those, of course, because it's all a sham.
Right.
All right. So going back, and thanks for your patience, because I know we've talked about Consilience Project a couple times. I cannot underscore how important it is in terms of, like, I think if we followed it through the Goebbels lineage, it's probably the same people behind the scenes. But this Jordan Hall, who we'll come back to, Santa Fe Institute, shocker. Mm-hmm. And then I just want to see here. Okay. So again, we have microbiology. So one person in this is editor-in-chief of Culture Kiosk.
Right.
And we have this geopolitical intelligence, and Bismarck's a part of it. And this same old guy's part of it. He was on Jim Rutt, because Jim Rutt only has people from here. But this is highly suspect. I looked up what this Culture Kiosk thing is, and I couldn't really find it. I'm not even sure if it's a real thing, but for what they claim to do, and then all the people who've taken an interest in this, I think it's a bit odd. Of course, we have our Brett Weinstein Fuller. So notice how it says journalism and media. He never calls himself a journalist. Notice this about him, because Rebel Wisdom is such a big part of this. And the things that he puts out, he calls them films, right? Yeah. No one else, they're not videos, they're films. So there's something in the film that I think lends itself to fiction.
Yeah. I do think he has some mixed feelings about what he does. It doesn't.
I think he does. I think he actually has some morality.
Very conflict. I don't know if I'd go that far, but I do think there's some conflict going on inside of him. I think he's doing one of these things, kind of like when somebody, like, it's like a noble lie, right? Like, I do think that he agrees with the direction all of this is going, that there are certain voices that do need to be drowned out. I do think he agrees with that. But I think he feels uncomfortable with lying to achieve intended goal. So he is trying to find a way to become okay with the fact that he is not being completely honest. And
right.
Film is one of those things that right?
Okay, I'm gonna pull him up while we're on it, because I think, oh, Rebel Wisdom is down. That's interesting. He does two distinctly different types of shows. And you can tell when he's shilling.
Right.
And there's a completely different kind of, there's just a different kind of tone and way that he carries himself versus when he's not. And you can see it specifically, but I don't want to get us off track, but hopefully there'll be time to jump to that. All right. So let me go back to the screen share. All right. So we have all these liars, part of it, philosophy, strategy, social psychology. That's a big part of it. Philosophy, more intelligent systems, economics, this cyber cash thing, former board member of Santa Fe Institute. Mm. Right. That's another thing that went awry for them.
Ron Perkins is on there. That's so fat. That's yeah.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. So I find this very interesting in World Economic Forum, young global leader, blah, blah, blah. So these are the people who are.
They know. So this is what makes no sense to me. This is the part that makes no sense, right? That they already know that people that they say need to have their brains washed, right, are suspicious of the Global Reset and the World Economic Forum. So the part that I don't understand is, like, wouldn't you just like try to evade the questions that you and I might have about something like that by not putting on the board someone from the world? Or
that's at least what's so weird is how it's so out in the open. And I think it speaks to their hubris. And I also think it speaks to, like, you know, if I'm guessing how David got sucked into this is, again, pleading to people's ego and saying, like, well, we're intellectually superior, so we know best how to steer culture. And then people are so excited to be part of this intellectual elite.
It's almost like people, they're trying really hard to convince people that they've been part of all of that, and they recognize that that is wrong, but that they are, because they were part of that, they are wise in the ways of the world that will make them somewhat respect, like, it's what this is. It's the synthesis, right? They're trying to grab some catchphrases and ideas like decentralization and whatever that will pull people who've kind of gone off the reservation. And they also want to, for some reason, maintain the respect of people who run the reservation. So they're like, you know, it's the synthesis. It's the consilience.
Right? Okay, so I want to come back to that. Well, you know what? Let me do it now, because I just found this. And like, these tabs have been open for so long that, like, me keeping track of why. Wait, sorry, guys, you don't need to see my email. Let me get to the tab, because I found something really interesting about consilience.
Eyes look much more green today than they normally look.
Your eyes?
Your eyes.
Mine do?
Yeah, like, your eyes are brownish hazel generally, but
they change a lot.
Yeah, but today they look much more green. That's interesting. Okay.
That is interesting. They do that. Shit, I'm trying to find this consilience thing. I just found it before we started the show. Oh, here it is. Okay. Ta-da! I mean, I'm a super shapeshifter. Okay, yeah. So this guy is.
See your reptilian slit too.
Really? So I've been working with my new reptilian puppet collection. Okay, so this guy is, we're on the Lifeboat Foundation Advisory Memorial Board, Kenneth W. Harris. He's dead, but he founded the Consilience Group.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see that?
Yep.
Okay, so I'm going to click it, because this is obviously a little bit different, but there is definitely something to this consilience. And I don't think so now it's gone.
So Rebel Wisdom is down. Wait, this is not accidental. Rebel Wisdom is down, and the link that was there last time you looked is now gone.
Shocker.
Right. So here's my thought.
Shocker. All
right. So you know when you are torn between something and you'll say something like, I'm of two minds about this, or yes. How am I going to reconcile knowing this on one hand, but feeling this way on the other hand? Well, the answer would be, if you reconcile them, you've reached consilience.
Consilience.
You have found a way to become David Fuller, to know something is wrong, but to be okay with it anyway.
Well, yes. And I mean, David Fuller is doing what consilience is doing, and we'll go deeper into it in a second, which is flat out fucking lying. Right. And demonizing people who think differently, but criticizing that in the media space in such a way that it makes it seem like he and they are not doing that because they're calling it out and saying this is bad faith communication.
Right. So he does this thing where he's like, okay, like he pretends as though he has fully examined the side that he sees as problematic, that he spent some time there. And so that qualifies him to politely and diplomatically speak about it and explain why we really have to discount that. Right. And the truth is, and you and I both know this, like anybody who has spent even 24 hours of honest research will come back and at least say, I still don't agree with them, but I understand why they think that way. And it needs more looking, right? Kind of thing. Cause there's something there, or like, you know, or whatnot. So he just is like, I looked at, I'm dismissing it. He's right. Kind of thing. He never comes back and says, you know, I think they're mostly wrong, but we really need to get to the bottom of why it is we have been okay with the Clintons doing this or the so-and-so doing that and whatnot, because it's been the media, us, our inability to take them to task and to follow that rabbit all the way down to the bottom of the hole that has led to these other stories around them that I'm still not convinced of, but that have flowered, and instead that you write kind of thing. So they never do that.
Well, they're intellectually dishonest.
They're intellectually dishonest, but they're also, yes, they're just not looking. But David, and this is the thing that I find so disturbing about him, he really thinks he is far more intelligent than some.
Oh yeah, just like Brett and Eric do.
But there's something, their own egos betray them. Like he
feigns humility.
Time working on this other kind of thing. Like there are some people out there that like I totally disagree with, and I think that they're a problem. But I can look at them and go, yeah, they're fucking pretty smart though. Like pretty smart. They may be smarter than me or whatever kind of thing, right? David is not. And so the idea that he is sitting here going, I am smarter than these other people just because I say so, and that I don't actually have to give an answer that is a real answer to any question they have because I'm smart because I say so, right? That's the...
Totally. Okay, so I'm like, in this moment, I'm tempted to jump to my rebel wisdom, that chart that I made in Jordan Hall, but I want to break down how Consilience Project is a propaganda arm. Are you feeling one or the other?
Let's do the Consilience thing, and then we'll go to the rebel.
Okay, cool. So let me pull it up again. I got so much shit open. Okay, we've got it. Okay. Sharing the screen. Okay, so Consilience Project as propaganda arm. So they put out these articles. We don't make propaganda, they do. And this is one thing that you will notice as our audience, as we start to track how all these Consilience Project people are on podcasts and writing articles, 99% of them are about propaganda. We just saw how none of them are actually qualified to be telling us about propaganda, but that is the function of Consilience Project. So I pulled some pieces from these articles, redefinitions of propaganda. They're telling us what it is. I made some notes. Okay, so when free speech started really be infringed upon and it was affecting my life, what I heard most frequently from people on the left was, it's not censorship if the government isn't doing it.
Right.
Okay, so this is what they're doing here. Propaganda is any media product that has been deliberately designed and distributed by or for a political group in order to cause political action. No, that's flat out fucking false. And one thing that you'll notice on the Consilience Project is that there are no authors attributed to their lies and bullshit and doublespeak, but they will offer many citations in all of their articles as though they're well researched. And 99% of those citations are other Consilience Project
right
articles with no author.
Reads an article and says from timcast.com. Yeah, whatever. Yeah,
totally. Exactly. So these are just some of the lies. So they're claiming to be good faith educators. Those seeking in good faith to serve as educators become also almost impossible to distinguish from those seeking to serve as culture warriors. I'm not even sure why I underlined that. But okay, propaganda must be understood as distinct from related phenomena such as disinformation, conspiracy theories, fake news, and other features of our damaged information. Commons, propaganda, and advertising are also distinct. Lies. Propaganda and advertising are not distinct, and propaganda is not unrelated to disinformation, fake news. It's all the same. All of their articles about propaganda are filled with such propaganda fucking lies. I don't know if you could tell, but it really pisses me off. And it claims that it's just for education purposes. Look at all the people who are their advisory board. They're just there to educate people out of the goodness of their heart. So that's the claim, and that it's not for profit, and there's no other ulterior motives going on with Consilience Project, which I think is one of the most dangerous operations, organizations, you know, cabals out there right now. I think we cannot underscore how dangerous that they are. Okay, so going to my links about this, let me just make sure I have the right ones. Okay, so there was this one piece about David Fuller. So I pulled up Rebel Wisdom just to kind of see what was going on his website. And I found on his website this, which I hope everyone can see. And he had this. So this was advertising Jordan Hall and Guess. We've already established that Jordan Hall is part of Santa Fe Institute. And then it just said at the bottom of his website, previous guests, including Ellen McGillchrist, Daniel Schmachtenberger, Noah Bateson, Douglas Rushkoff, I don't know how to pronounce that, and John McWhorter. So I was like, okay, he just threw all these out. Let me look all of them up. Every single person he mentioned, we have John McWhorter here, SFI. Douglas Rushkoff down here, Lifeboat Foundation. Nora Bateson, Consilience Project, she's also Lifeboat. We have John Ver whatever, also Consilience Project. Schmachtenberger, we know that he's both Lifeboat and Santa Fe Institute. So there's actually no one mentioned here who's not part of this trifecta of PSYOP that we're honing in on.
Circle jerk of self-contained flatulence again.
100%. And then just the last piece from this little section, Jordan Hall, Santa Fe Institute trustee, also partnered with Neurohacker Collective and Qualia, which is Daniel Schmachtenberger, what put him on the map, right? Co-founder Neurohacker Collective with Schmack. So are we starting to see how these are all interrelated, inextricably bound?
Yeah, no, I mean, I think you have this scenario, so there's a couple of things, right? You have like a working group that is trying to convince everybody that their work is noble by referring as evidence that it is to other people in the group that are trying to convince the public, right? And then it's also a lot of this, like, you can prove, the Bible proves God's existence, right? So like kind of thing, like, you know, right? So, you know, it's, it's not really different than like any other religion, government, or mind control operation at all. It's exactly the same, right? I looked up the consilience group on my phone.
Okay.
It's the weirdest thing I've ever seen on a Google return. There's no any, like, it just looks like this consilience group. Usually there's like more information than that, but there's a phone number and they open at 9 a.m. tomorrow morning.
You have to call.
Okay. So, but I think this consilience group is different.
I think it's different, but notice that it's coming out of Lifeboat, and both that Ken guy who started it and Schmacky are right. Higher ups at Lifeboat Foundation. I'm wondering if consilience group, whatever this guy Ken started, didn't move into consilience project. There's, because we've said there's something about that word that I do feel is significant.
What I'm saying is I think there's more than one consilience group.
I think so too.
Take a look, but I think that there may be something to that as well, because, you know, Michael and I, when you have multiple things with the same thing going on, there's some kind of connection. I'm going to look into it when we're not on the air a little bit more, because there's some interesting things popping up here. This is problematic on like a number of levels.
But use the P word. Yes. You hate that word.
I hate that word. Right. But it's almost like there's no, because 99% of the people that are going to be reached by the media products that these people are creating are not going to understand so much that these people are connected. Right.
That's the point of these shows right now, is to show everyone how you can't deny it.
The only what's weird is that, like, it's almost like they're trying to expose it in some their own shit in some weird way, because David Fuller has all of them on, and now it looks like Brett's going to be having.
They all have all of them on. If you look at Jim Rutt's show list and David Fuller's, it's only Consilience, FFI, SFI Lifeboat. There are no exceptions.
If you really think about it, like, this is, I think we're in the final stages of their op. And I don't know if their op is plan B or plan A. I actually think their op might be plan A. And I'll tell you why in just a second. But people who are listening to, people who came in through the Dark Horse portal, right, were people who were concerned about social justice warriors and critical race theory, and maybe interested in evolutionary biology. Mm-hmm. People who came in through the David Fuller portal were like people who are into spirituality and psychedelics, mm-hmm. and like kind of that kind of thing, right? And so you now have a scenario where they're listening to people who have nothing to do with their original interests, but somehow have become figures in the religion that they thought that they had joined. And so it's like when the religious organization starts to do community work, and suddenly, like, right, like, you know, here. So one of the big, have you seen any of these churches that have coffee houses in them?
No.
Okay. So that's a big thing here in Los Angeles, right? Like, and I discovered this by like, looking for the best craft coffee places in the Valley, because they're harder to find in the Valley than they are like in town.
Right.
And the two best coffee places in the entire San Fernando Valley are affiliated with churches. One of them is actually inside of a church, and the other is has one location in a church, and this one's not, but it's related to the church. Mm-hmm. And I think what I figured out is churches figured out that you can fundraise and not pay taxes based on doing something like this, maybe.
Okay.
Like, right? They have great coffee. Like, they have all the good coffee that I like from all the other places. But it's one of these things that, like, okay, so if I go to the one that's inside the church, because that's actually the best one, the one that's inside the church, if I go there enough times, maybe I'll get into a conversation with somebody, and right, and you know, and then that person will talk to me about coffee or whatever I'm interested in, and the slow roll will be getting me to entertain conversations about, God or religion, even if it's from like an intellectual perspective, as opposed to like a religious perspective.
Coffee's the Trojan horse.
Coffee is the Trojan horse. And it's just like slowly warming me up to it. Right. Kind of thing. So it's kind of like that, right? It's kind of like that.
It's not even kind of. I think it's very deliberate and calculated and strategized to be like that. And it's pinpointing these people who fancy themselves the intellectual elite and right. they're smarter than everyone. And it's playing into that of like, oh, these poor dumb people. So the thing is with all these guys, and I'll pop up back up into a second. Oh, and what I forgot to mention about Jamie Wheel is that Jamie Wheel put himself on the map with a book he wrote about Navy SEALs, and he was with them in a very deep way. Remember, we learned 2 shows back that you can't be a naval officer without doing a residency at SFI.
Right.
So even though I haven't directly connected Jamie Wheel to SFI, if he was immersed with Navy SEALs for as long as he was to write the book, and he's doing all this with all these lifeboat consilients people, and he's consilients, I think, you know, it looks pretty, it looks like there's an association there. So the other piece is that, as you said, Brett has abandoned, you know, what he used to talk about to instead tell us about the lollipop and the joy and all these other things that are not in his wheelhouse. And David has also taken a turn away, right? So they're doing that. What do they mostly talk about? Propaganda. What do all their consilience people on their shows talk about? Propaganda. Mm-hmm. Even though none of them are qualified to talk about propaganda.
What year was Consilience Project formed?
Let me see if I have it here.
How we lost our sovereignty and how to get it back.
Exactly. Why is this guy talking about this? Okay, wait, let me pull up Consilience. But I want you guys to see how consistent it is. Like, what did, you know, Jim Rutt was just on Dark Horse podcast. What did they talk about? Aside from mentioning QAnon at least 5 times, and I only got halfway through, so I'm sure it was more. They talked about propaganda.
Do you think, like, the few people that are still talking about QAnon exist solely so that these people can claim that there's still a QAnon thing going on?
I was wondering, I'm like, are they going to pull a new QAnon thing? Like, why are they talking about this so much now? It's so weird. Okay, so this is Consilience Project's about page. Look at their very artful Khazarian flag symbol.
Yeah.
Their project, research and analysis to help guide decision makers and leaders towards critical. I mean, it's just, everything is a word salad with these people. Mm-hmm. But I'm looking for 2021. They're new. And we looked up Civilization Research Initiative, which I don't believe actually exists.
Okay. So look, let's check it again. I wonder about that consilience group, because you had that picture of that guy who had started the consilience group. I wonder what year that would form, because it would be really interesting to know if that came about as part of the Smith-Mundt repeal, right? If that came right around that or right after that time.
I think it disappeared. I think I navigated away, but that's a really good...
Okay, I'm just looking up real fast. What is it? Civilian Research Institute?
Yeah, and I did look them up a couple weeks ago, and I could not find anything about this Civilian Research Initiative. The closest I got was finding a couple people on LinkedIn who were like working for their facilities. But I don't believe it's a thing. I think it's a shell fake thing that allows Consilience Project to not reveal who their donors are. Right. But I really couldn't find anything on Civilization Research Initiative. I'm not buying it. Also, the other thing to notice is like even on this Dark Horse with Jim Rutt and literally every David Fuller, they're always dropping Daniel Schmachtenberger's name. Like, they're really predictive programming, seeding the landscape with just the repetition of his name.
All right. So I looked up Civilian Research Initiative.
Mm-hmm.
No, nothing came up. But what
there's nothing. It's not a thing.
Listen to what this is. What came up was Minerva Research Initiative. And it says this is a part of the Department of Defense. And it's
Shocker.
Defense Education Institution and Civilian University Research Partnership mission to increase DOD social science expertise.
And that came up as connected to this?
When I searched Civilian Research Institute, it didn't say it's not available or anything like that. That Minerva thing came up top.
That is so weird.
Okay, so.
Okay, wait. So let me just get, I just want to get through these last pieces, if that's cool. So this guy, he's a big piece of it, this Samo Berja, and he's part of Consilience Project. And you and I talked about this offline, Emily.
Mm-hmm.
He's claiming to have this contrarian view on Ukraine, Russia.
Right.
And it's contrarian and off topic. In the same way that Brett and Heather were like, the lab leak. They're pulling the same op with this guy who's still running the primary narratives.
So I'm gonna give you his take, how I perceive it, because I listened to him for about 23 minutes this episode, is that they're claiming he's contrarian, but he's not contrarian what it's saying that, like, I think this is, like, in the overall thing, he's not saying you're wrong and I'm right. He's basically just saying Putin is not a madman. He's actually very intelligent, and this is what he's doing. But he's not saying that the United States or the narrative about Ukraine is wrong. He's basically just saying, like, this is the way the Russian mind thinks. This is what he's doing, blah, blah, exactly. blah. And there's exactly. that opposition. No, it's just clear thinking about what's happening, about, like, right? So is that your takeaway too?
Well, that was my takeaway. But he also, I mean, I ended up taking notes on this, on that show. And there was quite a bit of, I mean, I won't take the time. I mean, I did time code the clips, but there was a bunch of disinformation that was folded into it about, like, World War I and how he was saying there's no economic profit in war. I think that was a big piece of his disinformation. But yeah, like, he was running the same narrative, but it was, like you said, it was just like this kind of ancillary thing to disagree on. But then he showed up on Jim Rutt with the same thing. Like, it's all this insular circuit they're running together.
Yeah. They're all smelling each other's farts, basically, and saying it's brilliant.
Totally.
Guess what each other ate for dinner that produced the aroma of that fart? Like, the opposite of what we were talking about earlier with creating these little experiences through sensory, whatever. Like, they're going for the refuse, man.
Totally. Exactly. Okay, so the last piece, just to, like, put the cherry on top of the picture, is this guy, I'm not quite sure what this is. Oh, that's not it. So this guy, Zach Stein, he's also part of the Consilience Project. Oops, that just got erased. So Zach Stein is another one of these neurohacker guys. But look at, he's also doing the rounds on telling everyone about propaganda, education. Like, you've got all these neurohacker philosophy guys all of a sudden claiming expertise on propaganda and flipping it as part of how they propagandize us.
Right. Because they, like, oh, no, the person who warned us about propaganda is not going to propagandize us, right? So they're talking about propaganda now before they slip back into their real role, which is whatever thing they think they're expert at, right?
But it's weird. Notice how they've all ditched what they're supposedly experts at.
Back to it.
Right. But it's interesting how they've all taken on this role as propaganda experts, including Brett and Heather, and none of them are.
Right. So, but this is kind of like where people get into, and it's funny because they'll do it with these people and not with, they'll do it like with Alex Jones, right? Obviously, Alex Jones will say something, will tell you about propaganda, and he'll tell you not to believe him, to do your own research. And people will say, well, yeah, he's just saying that because, you know, by saying that, people will believe him, because if they didn't want, if he didn't want them to do their own research, he wouldn't say, go do your own research. So they'll say that about Alex Jones, but they're doing the same thing, right? So, and Alex Jones, like we talked about last time, the longer this goes on, the closer to batting 1,000 he becomes, you know what I mean? It's pretty, you know, yeah. But he, like, they're going to go back to what their chosen topic, what the thing that they were, so we have to be careful not to make the mistake to think that the thing that drew our attention to them was the reason that they were chosen. They were all chosen for a reason. And for some people, it's going to be the thing that first attracted us to it that they may return to. And with others, it's going to be some area that they're going to move into, right? Kind of thing. Like the CRT or the, not CRT, the social justice warrior or, you know, whatever, CRT kind of stuff is what attracted us to Brett and Heather. It's what got everyone's attention. But they're really evolutionary biologists. Right. And they do this a little display of their biology know-how during this pandemic. But now they're talking about propaganda. So like people be like, wow, they warned us not to fall for this other thing. So why would they warn us if they're just going to do it ourselves? And then they're gonna slip in the poison pill, which is like, this is the good vaccine. You can take this one. Blah, blah, blah. And the reason we know how is because, like, this is not gonna, you know, I think he just had a show the other day and I haven't had a chance to watch yet that was like, did we take the wrong vaccine?
I'm gonna invite you to be mindful of your language because we're on YouTube now.
Oh, thank you.
No problem.
Did we take the wrong lollipop? Did we enjoy the watermelon instead of the cherry or whatever, right? Thank you. Okay. So.
Wait, so they literally said that?
I didn't listen to it yet because, like, I almost don't listen to anything anymore. I just look at the titles of shit. But let me just go find it and show. Just
you know what was worth listening to though? Mo Fax and Adam Curry did a 3-hour breakdown of the fake Chris Rock Will Smith op and tied it into Quincy Jones as like the cleanup man and tied him into like Tupac's death and Biggie's death and like. How it's, and he's their handlers, and like they did such a great job. That is really worth listening to.
Okay. So let me just see if I'm able to. Okay. Here we go. All right. I have no idea what this is about. So I'm just being honest about that up front. I just try to glean whatever I'm going to glean by like looking at the titles in my feed. So here's the shows with Jim Rutt that you're talking about, right? And this was interesting. Yeah. Hyper novelty is a cold bitch, right? But here we go. This
so edgy. What an edgy title. They're right. So rebellious.
Have people been given the wrong lollipop?
Oh, let's talk to Robert Malone, Steve Kirsch, and Peter McCullough so they could give us a better one.
Right. So this is the whole, like, you know, this is going to be like their role. I'm just guessing here. I'm not saying this is right. But my guess would be that their role is going to be at some point to convince people of which ones are okay and whatnot. And there'll be a trust of course, because not only did they say no to the bad one, but they also educated you about propaganda, and propaganda is what the, you know, mainstream media put out on the bad one and this other, whatever it is. Right. But also because they're evolutionary biologists and a lot of people are concerned with the rewriting of certain papers or genetics, right? That may take us, evolve us into something different than what we are right now, or what maybe we think we ought to be, or whatever, that they either A, can be useful in trying to calm those concerns and say it's not, or could give a reason why that might actually be a good thing and look back into history and say, oh, well, when this new gas entered Earth's atmosphere, like, sure, some people died off, but it also, the ones who survived, it led to a 200-fold increase in intelligence and ability to manufacture handmade tools, whatever the fuck the story is going to be, right?
Right, right.
They're going to be there doing that. Right. Then you got someone like, okay, and I'm just making this up. I am making this up because I have never listened to Jamie Wheel. I have never heard about him from anybody but you, but I see his name on things after you brought my attention to it.
Right.
His main focus is, it seems like he's there to like sort of braid the hair of the military and psychedelics. Like,
boom, boom.
And so he's going to introduce us to sort of, like, we think of psychedelic, people like us who are educated in mind control, think of psychedelic warfare as like, okay, they fed people psychedelics, and then they mind controlled them in a cult, and they blah, 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 MK Ultra. Da, da. I think what he's there to do is to introduce this idea that psychedelics can give us an advantage in warfare, and what we think of as like more battlefield warfare. Ooh. In terms of like this, like, I think that's where that's eventually going to go, right? That we're going to be starting these cults. We're going to have ethical cults. We're going to raise children in them, and we're going to have children. I'm making this up. I'm not saying this is like just a scenario I'm making up. Maybe it's true. Children are going to be raised in these cults, and these cults are going to be mushroom eating cults or ayahuasca drinking cults or whatever it is. And these are going to have tremendous visual acuity, and they're going to be able to see into other realms, because what we're going to be dealing with in the future is hyperdimensional warfare, right? And we need people practiced at navigating those spaces in order to protect the home dimension. It's not going to be a land anymore. It's going to be, I'm making this up, right? But it's just like, so you'll have stuff like that. And then I'm trying to think if there's, I've never listened. I don't even know what Jordan Hall really does. I'm trying to think of one other person from this shit show that I know what they do. Which other ones do I know what they do?
Tristan Harris, you know.
Tristan Harris. Like, I don't, that's going to be like the, you know, the, I think he's just there with the more ethical social media kind of thing.
Well, the one thing about Harris, which is a through line, and by the way, Jordan Hall goes by Jordan Greenhall and Jordan Hall. He's changed his name, and it's kind of hard to track him. But Tristan Harris, I think he planted the seed, which you will hear Jim Rutt, Jordan Hall, Daniel, you'll hear all of them talk about, which is that we're all being controlled by AI and social media, and we're too feeble-minded to realize that social media is running us, which is why we can't have free speech, because AI doesn't understand nuance or sarcasm, and we don't realize that we've been radicalized as QAnon, alt-right Nazis. I think that's Tristan Harris's function in that.
Legitimize like some sort of like plug-in or like thing we plug into our computer or our phone to alert us of like when we have reached the capacity of information we can take in for that day without it kind of thing, right? So like, let's just say we're listening to YouTube and we're writing emails, and that thing can, by analyzing our emails, let us know that this thought has infiltrated and da da da, da, right? It's going to legitimize, like, we're going to be wanting to monitor ourselves for that. See what I'm saying?
And oh, that's interesting. See, I didn't take it to such a tech place. I thought it was straight up like he's legitimizing no more freedom of speech.
100%, right? 100%. But like, people are so much more okay with being in prison if there's like a fun little device attached to it that they can play with. So think about car insurance companies that want you to put that thing in your car that, like, if you're driving, if you're doing a good job driving, it will lower your premiums. You know what I'm talking about? Have you seen it? Okay. It's going to be like that, right? Kind of thing where it's like, you're going to be able to have a little device that will let you know when your speech patterns or the way you're expressing yourself is reflecting having been influenced by some idea. And of course it'll be tinted by an algorithm that points only in one direction, right?
But I think he's also tied into the social credit system and tying it into our internet use.
You're going to offer this device that will allow you to catch yourself before you lose your points. And then it's fun.
Yeah. Yes. I can totally see that.
All right. Yeah. So I think these are like, right. And so, but for now, it's really important that they all coalesce and sing us a song about propaganda, right? It was kind of like, think about how much benefit it did to the overall image of all those rock stars that either performed at Live Aid or sang We Are the World, right?
And I love how Prince refused.
Right, of course he did, right? But it kind of, all of those people, like, that lent them a certain level of legitimacy, right? Yes. or like people were willing to give them like the benefit of the doubt or a goodwill. So this is kind of like all of these retards singing "We Are the World."
Yes, totally, totally.
We're absolutely coming together. We're coming together to give people a hand, to help the world out in this moment of dire need. We're going to sing you this song that's going to put you back to sleep, and then we're going to get you with all the other shit.
Yes, 100%. 100%.
All right. So,
Wait. One last piece. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, anything else you want to put down in the public hour?
So just one last piece. And I want, this is just an example, because you, if you guys go through David Fuller's Rebel Wisdom, you'll see the exact same thing. But just to give you guys an idea of how obvious this is Jim Rutt's podcast. Okay. Ilan McGilchrist, we've already established, he's a Consilience Project. Nort Bateson, Consilience Lifeboat. Mm-hmm. Samo Bergeau, we talked about, Consilience Project.
You know what this reminds me of? Like, okay, so a lot of people, when they first start throwing parties,
Rushkoff, Lifeboat.
Okay.
Right, go ahead.
When they first start throwing parties, like dance music parties, right? They'll get their first big headliner from a particular agency, right?
It's the same circuit. Like they get, go ahead.
Right. It's the same circuit. Right.
Same circuit.
They all have the same. It's like this. So a person will be starting to throw parties, and they'll have had a few local parties, and now they're ready to like book somebody that they're going to bring in. So they'll contact this agent, and they'll say, "I want so and so, big name." The person that person's not really available or whatever. I do have this other person, and that other person,
same booker with all their clients.
The other person that you want is pretty high dollar, and like we need to make sure that you throw the kind of parties we like first. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna give you like our newest artist, almost no name at all, but like maybe someone will have heard of them. If that goes well, then you can kind of work your way up. But what they've tricked you into doing is booking everybody on their roster, exactly. Right? And then once you've booked everyone and had their headliner, now you have a relationship with them, and they'll give you some way cheaper prices, but they've already built you into paying for a bunch of people you would normally never have paid money for, right? It's kind of like that. Like they're only going down the roster of the particular agent that is running, like basically running them right now. That's exactly. And they never go off that list, right?
They never go off the list. That's it. Like, and that's what I'm saying. Like once you see it, you can't unsee it. So we have this John Vervecki guy who we talked about, we know Pinchback, Jim Rutt, again, Megan Dom, she was a little bit different, but that was, I was kind of hoping.
Really, but not really, right? Like she's
New York Times, she's LA Times.
There's a few people that like, when you listen to them, like they say some things, they seem like reasonably normal people and they say some things you can agree with, right? Yep. There's like always somebody who could make their point better, but doesn't sign on to all the rest of the bullshit that they should have on instead, but they don't sign on to all the rest of the bullshit. So yeah, totally.
Yeah, totally. But it's all the same little club. And that's kind of all I wanted to say. So guys, just start to pay attention of like, who's in the Consilience Project, what they're talking about, how they're cross-pollinating, how they're all repeating sense making and pushing schmacky, and that's kind of all I got.
Yeah, so totally. But I think we've identified this thing that like you're not getting on any of those shows if you're not part of one of those three. And I think there probably are a few more related organizations that we haven't yet discovered that
probably
they'll be like, see, we booked somebody who's not part of that, but they're secretly in this other backroom cabal that is related to.
Totally. But even like Pinchback, you could tie into MAPS, which we've already shown their relationship with Lifeboat. So I feel like it's always going to be at least, you know, 6 degrees, but not even, probably like a 3 degrees. Like
3 or 4 is the farthest they're going to go out.
Probably.
I think that it's 6 degrees has gotten a little too dangerous. That's where they've gotten into.
Right.
Someone who doesn't quite at all, right? So I think 3 or 4 is as far as they can go right now.
And also Rogan, like we haven't tied Rogan to any of these, but if you look at Rogan's guests, similar through line.
Well, the thing with Rogan is super big. So he works with multiple booking agents. We're using the throwing parties idea, right?
Yeah.
like, it's like when people have been in the party game for years, or they throw big festivals, they work with multiple agents, right? They work with lots of different people and they have access to lots of different things by that point. And so, you know, he has multiple groups that he works with, mm-hmm. like part, I think he is part of several different operations, mm-hmm. right? Because he's a man of many, like, color, like he serves a lot of purposes.
Yeah. And his net is cast way wider,
right?
Way so wider.
Like, let's say his circle has six segments, and right. And this part is kind of one segment, maybe overlaps into a second segment based on his own personal interests and things like that. But yes, you
can, he gets more leeway. His leash is longer.
His leash is longer, and he is allowed to go to the 6 degrees space.
Yeah, totally.
Like, he's the most important person to maintain legitimacy for them.
Totally. Okay, one last thing before we go, and I know this is so long, but I just wanted to share this one piece, and then this kind of like ties up this whole longer thing, is we're back on Lifeboat now, and this is their executive staff. So this is the name to really pay attention to. Have you heard of him, Emily?
Philip Van Nitterville. No, but I think I saw him on one of the other pages you showed earlier.
He's been on the other pages. So check this out. He's an international spokesperson, but when we scroll down, he's director of informational transparency division. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And this goes the bunkers division.
Totally. But this is the thing. So I look him up, and this is the same pattern we see with all of them. Virtual reality specialist. He's a futurist, right? He's big with nanotech.
Mm-hmm.
He's again, nanotech stuff. Expert. Yeah. No fucking background in media at all. But once again, we have a scientist who's presenting himself as the information transparency overlord, right?
You know, I mean, his name makes me think of, go back to his page. Go back to the Lifeboat page right there. When I see his name, Van Nitterville, it makes me think of Dynevenbelt from the Law of Man on the High Castle. And Dynevenbelt means the next world. That's what Dynevenbelt or Nevenbelt, I can never remember how it says. It means the next world, like the new world, right? The next world. And it was the name that they had for their project or their machine that they were trying to send people to the other universe. And it was in an underground bunker. Did you, like, I'll show you, like,
stop. I did try to watch that because you urged me to, but I can't with all the creepy. But I did see like 5 or 6 episodes.
Stop the screen share. I'm just going to show you a real quick. So I'm not going to go the route that ties it to the glass bead game, but that route is there too. I'm going to do the route that sticks to what we're talking about here. This is what it looks like. So this is the word Dynevenbelt, right? Dynevenbelt. And I'm going to screen share so you can see here. Dynevenbelt means the next world, the other world, right? And this is what the machine kind of
Wait, the list of, okay, so it's a machine, it's not a person.
It's a machine, it's a tunnel in an underground bunker, right? That they were trying to send, like they were experimenting, sending Jewish people through.
Okay, so go back, just go back real quick. I wonder if we went through that list of Nazi science and technologies, how many of those science and technologies would also line up with names of people on the boards of Lifeboat?
Right. Oh, that's really good. Yes. Right? Yes. Yeah. Okay. These lists right here, this is a wiki fandom list, which probably means it's real. Right.
Right.
But that's what it makes me think. And if you look at this from right here, it looks like a keyhole.
Key.
Right. Key. Here's the key. And what they were doing is they were sending Jews. They were using Jews to try this. And most of them were coming back either really maimed or dead. Because the deal was basically that, like, it only actually worked to send someone over if they didn't exist in the other reality. If the person already existed in the other reality. So, like, if there's another world, and as long as there was no Danny Katz in, then if they sent Danny Katz over, you'd be able to go.
Well, as soon as you said that, I'm envisioning these ovens, and, like, were they really ovens?
Right. And that, right? Which then also, there's so many layers you can get to with it. But that person's name, as soon as I saw it, it made me think Dynevenbelt. Right.
Intuitively, this guy, because I've been digging on him, and intuitively, I just feel like this guy's got to be into some really evil shit. Yeah. I haven't found anything super damning, but that's just my gut.
Well, there's feeling. One more weird thing about it, and I'm going to be a little bit cryptic about it. But he also looks remarkably like someone you used to spend a lot of time with and know very well.
Really?
Yeah, we'll take another look.
Do we have a picture of this guy?
I'm trying not to betray your confidence here.
Oh, I know who you're talking about. Yes, yes, yes.
Possibly, like, yes. So I think we should
big not, time.
Right? Okay.
And that was another one, by the way, where he picked me.
Yeah, that's exactly why I'm saying this. Okay.
Okay.
So, anywho, okay. So, the last thing I wanted to say before we move into the next part is that I think this might be plan A. I don't think this is in case like the really big op doesn't work. I think they have no doubt the really big op is not going to work, mm-hmm. right? They have no, they've game theoried this out a million times. They've used looking glass and all those kinds of technologies and all, right? They've used remote viewers. They've done the standard surveys of things like this. They're getting so ridiculous with the shit that they're saying, right? Like in terms of like, okay, the Pfizer CEO said there will be Bluetooth chips in the pills and that, right? Kind of thing, like, which isn't exactly the same thing as chips and the lollipop, but you know, like, so they're putting all this stuff out there because this is the real plan. Like, this may have always been, they may not have even decided that they needed to have consilience 10 or 15 or 20 years ago because the other thing wasn't going to work. This may have been the plan all along because this is really interesting. Like, this gets into super weird shit. Like, there's nothing super weird about FEMA camps and chips and pills. That's just tyranny, right? This kind of shit creates all sorts of like novel weirdness that they fucking love, right? And
that makes sense. Well, and that also lines up with what you were saying, that the first chunk of plan A was always just an intelligence test that I think people are mistaking
correct.
For the end game.
Correct. And like, what, it is not really fun just to have everybody in a jail cell or a pen or a FEMA camp. What's really fun is like experimenting in the lab. Let's go back to the lab, Walter. Like, I know, let's go back to the lab. It's much more fun to mix this with that and see what happens if you do this and that and the other thing and whatever. And it's probably also like, they're fucking loving that we're doing this. And I don't think that means that we should stop, right? Because I think they actually take a certain sick pleasure in this to a certain extent, right? Like to see like, how far we can go with the information being out there and people going along with it anyway, because right. it's cool. Because those people have been like the cool chosen cloud, and you and I are the two whiny Jewish bitches off making, you know, fucking a pain in the ass of ourselves, right?
So
I think that this is all like, at this point, like we're just all part of the merry pranksters, like, right, kind of thing. Like, this is like, I think. There's probably certain people with ego issues that are bothered by this, but like the people who are perpetrating this are like, this is great. Bring it on. Like, let's experiment with this too. Right.
Right.
So, you know, more is just more for them.
Right.
Yeah. All right. We're going over to the afterwards segment, wordspodcast.locals.com. If you have not joined us there yet, there will be a discount code down below. Can find all sorts of interesting stuff there. One of these days, real soon, we'll sort of be expanding on an option over there for premium subscribers and whatever. But for now, that is this or this is that, and we'll be over there. And we're going to talk about the comment and the thing I forgot to say about Daniel Pinchbeck last time. Any last words?
Save the date, June 13th, Language of Healing webinar. More information to follow soon. You totally want to be there. It's life-changing technology. We're welcome.
Yay! Bye!
Bye!